For the month of October, I needed to find the boat a new home, so I moved it less than half a mile across the harbour to East Boston.
From here, we can see the old mooring field where the boat was kept, along with some fantastic views of the city. And it's a pretty short walk to the new one. You can see the mast from here, actually.
This is East Boston, so we are one stop on the T away from Boston proper. And it's like the last bastion of affordable real estate left in the city.
It also looks like this. And this is the boat's new home, Pierce Park Sailing Centre.
Because this facility doesn't have a launch service to take us to the boat, I needed to pick up a dinghy. It was on our to-do list for next season anyway, but this expedited the purchasing process, so it was off to Craigslist, and $300 later I had picked up this small 7-foot dinghy and an electric trolling motor that the guy threw in with it.
I wanted to talk a little bit about how I single-hand this boat, and it's a pretty easy boat to single-hand. It's a 30-foot boat and plenty of people single-hand much bigger boats, but it's got a couple of conveniences that make it very easy to single-hand. Things like an autopilot, a lot of the lines are led back to the cockpit, things like that just make it a little bit easier.
The first thing I do is turn the battery switch to all, turn on the VHF, the autopilot, and the depth sounder.
Here's the two things that help me single-hand the boat the most.
This is the first. It's a Raymarine autopilot from the early 2000s. When I first started out, I relied on this quite a bit, used it as a bit of a crutch, if anything. But that's kind of a bit of a fool's game, because it's been notoriously unreliable. And when it does fail, it can be quite stressful. I'm able to set the course that it's to hold by pressing auto, and then clicking on this wheel lock right here. The course can be adjusted in 10 degree or 1 degree increments, and pressing the two of these together initiates a tack. And it makes tacking a lot easier because where the jib sheet winches are is a little bit away from the helm, and it's kind of hard to get the right turning angle on a tack, break one side of the winches, and then pull in on the other. This is the other useful tool when single-handing. It's a knob for tightening the steering wheel brake. And odd as that might seem, when the boat is pretty well balanced, just tightening this up a little bit can be enough to keep the boat going straight. Next up, it's time to raise the mainsail. I used to do this under autopilot out in the harbour, but I found it much easier to do it on the mooring and then motor out.
Then it's time to unzip the sail cover, attach the main halyard.
At this point, I pull in on the main halyard through the locked rope clutch so it can't slip backwards. It's possible to get it 3/4 ways up before needing to attach it to the winch and start pulling in the rest of the way.
Next up, it's time to start the engine.
This was also my first time towing the dinghy, so I was being extra careful to make sure I didn't wrap the lines around the prop. Once it's time to leave, I make sure we're completely head to wind, run forward onto the foredeck, untie the mooring lines, run back, and get ready to take the helm. I've taken to leaving the mooring field under sail wherever possible. It's a useful skill to have in the event that the engine was ever to fail. But you'll notice that I've also got the engine running in the background here, just as a backup in case the boat starts drifting somewhere that I don't want it to. Then it's time to unfurl the head sail. First I make sure the furling line will run free, then start pulling on the sheet. I used to unfurl the head sail about 80 to 100% of the way. It comes out to a maximum of 130, and this meant that I could see under the head sail as I was leaving the harbour with boats passing by me. Now though, if the harbour's quiet and it's not particularly windy, I'll almost always pull it the whole way out.
Well, towing is working out okay so far.
One of the great things about the autopilot is it means I can leave the helm, even if the sails aren't perfectly balanced. I can take a peek around the head sail to make sure there's no incoming traffic, and I can even tie off this reefing line that I noticed hanging loose. Once I'm done, back to the cockpit, and I'll disengage the autopilot again. My destination for the day was Specatcle Island, a mere 10-mile round trip from the mooring field, some 90 miles short of the last trip that we shared. Specatcle is at the mouth of the inner harbour, and it's the first island you come across leaving the channel, but there are many harbour islands to explore.
We're just coming up to Specatcle Island, which is where I was gonna stop and try to get to shore with the dinghy. Been to shore on Specatcle before, but I swam. So the process to get into the mooring here is gonna be, first off, furl in the head sail. And then turn on the engine. From there, I'll drop the mainsail, then I will motor in as slowly as possible approaching a mooring.
Grab the boat hook, spend the extra 20 quid on the telescoping one, worth its weight in gold when single-handing. Run up to the foredeck with the engine in neutral, reach out with the boat hook, and cleat off the mooring. I wasn't so happy with the pennant on this mooring, so I went back and grabbed some spare line to rig my own as a spare. Pretty sure what I made was a bit of a chafe monster, but I knew it was going to hold for a couple of hours just fine. Then it was time to take the dinghy into shore. There's a dock for the island ferry, and there's also a small marina, but it's been closed since some winter damage happened a couple of years back. And I couldn't find anywhere to tie up the boat, there were signs everywhere saying no docking, so I ended up having to go around the corner and make a beach landing instead. I pulled up the engine, floored it, at least as much as you can with an electric motor, and then hopped out, magically managing not to get wet. Made it to Specatcle Island. There's the dinghy. There's the boat. Now I'm gonna go see what Specatcle Island has to offer. Specatcle Island served as a dump for the city of Boston beginning in the mid-1800s and remained in such use right up until 1990. Then during a large-scale excavation project known as the Big Dig, the excess topsoil generated by the tunneling machines was moved out to Specatcle Island. The result was a complete transformation of the island, turning it into its present form, a beautiful park just outside of Boston.
So this was the highest point on the island. And we're at 95 feet above water level right now. All of this was added as part of the excavation of the Big Dig. And this is all the excess topsoil they filled in. In the distance, you can see the Long Island Bridge, which was actually blown up about 2 years ago. Big demolition job because it was deemed condemned or structurally unsound. Which is a real shame because now there's no access to Long Island and there used to be a homeless shelter out there. A lot of people have been displaced because of that. And I guess there's no plans to replace it either. This is one of my favourite sails to do here. Around Specatcle Island, in between Long Island and Specatcle, along what's called Sculpin Ledge. On the horizon you can just about see Graves Light poking through. To the left is Deer Island. To the right is Nix's Mate, Shag Island, and a couple of others. Through the gap we can see Lovell Island, Paddock Island, there's Long Island. Incidentally, I think this was the inspiration for that book, Shutter Island, and the subsequent movie. I'm not sure if the movie was filmed in the island or not. Here's a great view of South Boston. We've got the JFK Museum on the horizon. Coming around we see some of the South Boston yacht clubs, Pleasure Bay, and then the Port of Boston, Fort Point, and the city skyline. Made it to the summit. Incredibly arduous, 100-foot hike.
Most people get to Long Island by ferry. Of course, the advantage of coming by your own boat is you don't need to worry about the ferry schedule.
Of course, what you do need to worry about is dragging this heavy fucker into the water. This little trolling motor is fantastic. It goes at a reasonable pace as well. Heading back to the boat. The fog that was forecast for earlier has finally started to close in and I can't really see the skyline from here, so I think it's time to head back.
Here's how I tack when single-handed. I'll show you two ways. First I'll use the autopilot, then I'll hand steer.
So we're as close to the wind as can be. You can ease up on the steering wheel brake a little bit, engage the autopilot arm, and turn it on. Now, since we're going to tack soon, I'm going to pop out the handle here, put it over here so that I've got easy access to it. And now I'm ready to break this winch over here. To engage the tack, I press the two buttons together, then I'm going to run forward, break the winch, and pull in on the other side. Let's go! Head to wind. Jibs back window.
What I like about this technique is I can pull in on the sheet to the point where the sail is trimmed perfectly for the new course of sail before the tack is even finished. No need to break out the winch.
So the next tack, I'll do it by just hand steering. So I'm going to tighten up the steering wheel brake a little bit so that I don't need to give as much input to the wheel. I'm going to put one wrap around this winch and get ready to break this winch. And I'll bring the handle over again because I probably will need it this time. So we're moving a little slow, but we're going to go for it anyway. Helm's hard over. Break this winch. Shooting this winch. Keeping an eye on the turn as I can. Ease off on the wheel a little bit. Clean it off.
At this point, I'll make sure we're steering as close to the wind as we can get on this new tack before breaking out the winch and getting ready to trim properly.
Now that we're coming up on Pierce Park Sailing Center, it's time to do the whole thing in reverse. So I'm going to pull in the head sail first. To do this, I get ready to ease the active head sail sheet, and then I start pulling in on the furling rod. And again, since it's low winds, this should be nice and easy, but it can be very difficult.
With the head sail stowed, I drop the mainsail and moor the boat just like I did on Specatcle Island.
Some things that helped me out a lot starting out, having an autopilot, I think it would have been quite difficult and intimidating without it. For the first couple of tries, bring somebody else with you and just have them sit back and relax while you do all the work. That way, if something doesn't go well, you've got a backup member of crew to help you out. That's what I did. Having a big bay to practice in, where there isn't a lot of boats, a lot of sailboats going over and back, really helps. Furling out the head sail maybe 70-80% of the way, I found helped me out a lot in the beginning, so that I could see behind it and see where other boats were at all the time. It gave me a lot of peace of mind, and it was much easier to handle through tacks as well. In fact, in heavy wind, I'll still only furl out at most 100% of the head sail. So that's it, that's how I single-hand aboard this 30-foot sailboat, a Catalina 30. I'm not saying it's the perfect way to single-hand a boat, but it's worked okay for me so far. If anybody has any tips, tricks, or anything I could be improving on, any other suggestions, I'd be glad to hear it.
So that's it for this video. Thanks so much for watching. We're hoping for one more trip this season, but we're also nervously tracking the path of Hurricane Matthew, so let's see what happens. On the right, you'll see some other videos that might be of interest, and please do subscribe to the channel of Sailing Vessel, previously known as Solitude, currently known as Untitled, and future to be known as... well, more on that soon.